thanks to Jay for like, you know, curating this and accompanying this piece through the whole process. Also Erin Sitzik, and the audience who is tuning in today. Yeah, so I'm gonna jump into it. Let me start sharing my screen and telling you a bit more about some past works and some recent works, including the work at the Kemper. So I usually start my presentation with this work from 2014. The work that I was doing before is also informed by performance and other practices, but it's more situated in like thinking about gender and gender roles. Oh, sorry, I should read a statement before I start jumping into my work. So let me get to that. To just as a general contextualizing. My work is a reassertion of self, an exercise of unlearning, decolonizing, and exercising imposed histories, cultures, and ideas. I make interdisciplinary work that explores the performativity of tropical identity as a product, the performance of labor, decoration, beauty, leisure, service, and the body within it all. It's about reconciling the experience of having grown up in the Dominican Republic with living and navigating the US and the global North, using gaps, disconnections, and misinterpretations in representation as fertile ground for creativity. I've learned there is a gaze thrust upon me, which others me. I turn it upon itself, mainly by seeming to fulfill its expectations, but instead sabotaging them, thus regaining power and agency. So I was saying that my work before 2014 is more preoccupied with gender as it relates to family history and domestic space. And it's from 2014 on that I'm thinking about constructions of gender in relation to landscape and an outside space, which is what relates more to what is installed at the Kemper. So the work that you're seeing here is called Siboney from 2014. And it's a mural painting, but also a video that documents a performance. And let me go into an excerpt of this piece. So for the, for the video of Siboney, the video documents the process of painting this mural onto the museum wall, and has this subtitles on top that is talking about the ideas that I'm thinking about in relation to the piece. And what I'm painting is a pattern from a piece of fabric that I found. And the idea with the piece is that I am myself the machine of reproduction of this pattern, and I am the labor that is putting this pattern on the wall. And I'm also eventually undoing the pattern with my body, which you will see a little bit of at the end. And this all occurs during the length of a month, the performance of painting the pattern onto the wall, Monday to Friday, 9 to 5. And the second performance of undoing the wall, the paint on the wall, occurs for about 15 minutes, and it's me dancing to the beat of the song Siboney, which you will hear in a minute, or you're hearing already. While dancing to the beat of the song, after pouring water on myself, I am undoing the painting. The painting is made with gouache, so it's reversible.
Quiero y que todo tesoro
And then so as you saw, the work is about undoing those constructions of femininity in relation to the construction of the tropical landscape as it is visualized through this type of patterns. And this is the first time that I use this type of tropical pattern that I've kept using since in different ways. This piece is called Ridicode. A tropical theme is a great way to create a fresh, peaceful, relaxing atmosphere. And Ridicode is a word that I made up from redecorating, but also decoding. And a tropical theme is a great way to create a fresh, peaceful, relaxing atmosphere is a quote that I found on an interior design blog that was kind of prescribing this idea of putting a tropical theme on your walls to like refresh in your atmosphere. But Ridicode is an appropriation of a pattern from 1942 that was designed by Don Lauper for redecorating the Beverly Hills Hotel with a design of like big lush palm leaves or banana leaves, sorry. During a time that there were a lot of US occupations and interventions, military interventions and straight up invasions in places like Guam, Hawaii, Central America. So I was interested in that contrast between how tropical landscape was imagined as this space for freshness and peace, when it was in reality being occupied. And then in the, so I appropriate the original wallpaper, which is very neatly drawn, and I pixelate it through different layers, like different little sizes of pixels, and print it back into wallpaper. And I insert these QR codes that when you scan it with your phone, it will show you a number of links that I put in there. And these are some of the links that it will show you. So it shows you a variety of things from Banana Republic, the Wikipedia article on the political concept, but also Banana Republic, the store. These designs applied to products, different quotes from things that I was reading, from text that was unpacking the ideas of the exotic to this book that I found on Amazon called Strange, this strange book called Perfect Phrases in Spanish for Gardening and Landscape and How to Communicate with Your a Spanish speaking gardener. And also more products. The US military uniform at the time, they reverted this back to the kind of more organic shaped camouflage, but for a number of years it was this pixelated camouflage pattern, which resembled then what this installation ends up looking like. Similarly, Ridicode 2, La Dorada, is based on a wallpaper called El Dorado that was designed by Zuber, a French wallpaper company that started in the 1700s or 1800s, and it's still working today. And El Dorado is a wallpaper design that originally shows you four continents, Europe, Asia, the Americas and Africa. And Europe is the only one that has this kind of staircase that leads you in the landscape, in the drawing, that leads you to this elevated platform from where to see the landscape. Whereas the other continents have this kind of wilderness in the foreground. And then you can see some maybe semblance of buildings in the background far away. Which are decisions that are already kind of doing this, implying these differences of civilization and the wild and inserting ideas, colonial ideas. So similar as with Ridico number one, I was interested in subverting or frustrating visibility, thinking about, again, how these patterns are very preoccupied with neatly describing, visually describing imagery that you can identify. So in some of the advertisements of the time that this wallpaper was made, some of the text that, you know, came along with like sales, I don't know, catalogs, it talks about some of the silver catalogs talk about sitting in your living room and giving a geography lesson to your kid based on their patterns and being like, these are the people that inhabit the Pacific or whatever, because they have also a wallpaper about the Pacific islanders and people. But thinking about how this preoccupation with detailed visual description is tied into a history of, say, botanical illustrations being a tool for assessing newfound resources in these places that were quote unquote discovered, and then taking control of those resources and utilizing them. So in consideration of that, I'm interested in frustrating that need visibility and making it abstract or opaque in different levels and to different degrees. Tropticon is a an installation that I did at Socrates Sculpture Park in 2018 and 2019, from September to April or May, I think, where I appropriated a commercial greenhouse kit that you can buy and put together in your backyard and have a greenhouse there. And I covered it with one-way visibility vinyl, perforated vinyl, like the ones that you see in, say, a bus, when you're sitting inside a bus and you can, from the outside, it has an advertisement on the window, but when you're sitting inside, you can look out. So that like one-way visibility vinyl technology is implemented here to create the same effect, where like from inside the greenhouse, you can see the site-specific landscape, whereas from the outside, it's this design that is pixelated images of photos that I took at the New York Botanical Garden in the greenhouses of the outside of the greenhouses of the New York Botanical Garden. And similarly, as with the previous two pieces, I'm interested in this history of botanical exploration as it is related to colonialism. And also I'm playing here with the idea of the what is expected from a greenhouse in a global north context, where the type of things that you expect to find inside are this exotic plants that are, you know, kept under a controlled environment to keep alive under a geography, inside a geography where they wouldn't be able to be alive normally because of the cold. But then this one, when you go inside, you don't find exoticness, but emptiness that offers you the site-specific landscape. So I was very interested in that transformation, and also in relation to ideas of immigration and shelter. It's called Tropticon, which is a play on the word panopticon, which is an idea by Foucault, who talks about the panopticon as this place from where you can see everything, but people cannot see you. It was implemented in jails. But thinking about this idea again of control and visibility and creating these different hierarchies that are inverted from what is historically accurate. Dominican Women Google Search is an installation, going back to Siboney, to that like initial piece that I showed you, when I was, let me see what the next image is. No, okay. so I didn't include here, but when I was doing Siboney and thinking about it, one of the things that prompted me to do that work was the experience of coming to the US as an undergrad student. I was born in New York. I was raised in the Dominican Republic, and then I came back for undergrad. And slowly learning about the ideas that were related to me as a person from the Caribbean, as a Dominican woman, as a person with an accent, and as a woman in general. So I was constantly running into these ideas of exoticness projected onto me. And at some point I Googled, while I was doing that other piece, Siboney, I Googled Dominican women. And from the Google search results that I found that were very, very monotonous and repeated photos of women posing in the landscape basically, but in sensual or hypersexualized ways in tropical landscape. From those photos, I started doing collages that I eventually printed as postcards. So these are four of my postcards left in a gift shop in the Dominican Republic surreptitiously without telling anyone, along with like postcards that you can find in there. So I did these collages from this Google search that I printed as postcards, and the postcards were in different directions. Some postcards, some of the images that I found were photos of men that wanted to date a Dominican woman in their vacation from online catalogs that existed for those purposes. So like online websites for going through catalogs of women and picking one for dating in your vacation. So this is one of the photos from those. And then my intervention would be this. Some of the collages / postcards go in direction of wanting to make new bodies out of the bodies that I found in this like static poses, and trying to like recombine different parts of the bodies and making new ideas. Some of them are thinking about women in specific landscapes, so like the beach landscape, but also women and landscape in relation to each other as they are paired with each other in this source, in this search, in this Google search often, but also in images of the Caribbean and images of the tropic. This is a trope that repeats of women posing with landscape. And in some of them, I replace the image of the woman with a pattern from one of these tropical patterns that I was looking at. And I'll go back to this later in subsequent work, because this later inspired a different series that relates to what is being shown at the Kemper. A different direction on this postcard / collage series is a direction that has to do with art history, as I started noting that the way that women were posing in these searches had a relationship with the way that women were made to pose in art history, in paintings that were made by white men that went to tropical places. So like Gauguin, Grau Araujo, he was Colombian, but he was of a certain class and a certain race in Colombia. And then his subject here is a mulatto woman. And then further thinking about bodies and landscape and how to like mess with those two ideas. This one actually ended up being the sketch for what ended up being the installation. So the series of postcards, what eventually became postcards that I left in several gift shops, also ended up in this, which is # Dominican Women Google Search, the installation. And I'll show you a quick video of this so you understand more how it exists in space. Sorry, I can't see. Okay. So After doing the collages and doing dealing with these cutout pieces for a while, I started printing them in human scale. So a face would be the size of a face and an arm would be the size of an arm. And as I printed them in the scale, they started pixelating. So I emphasized that by the way that I cut the print on this Sintra board. And then the back of the board was covered with fabric from shirts that I had collected from thrift stores, men's shirts that I had collected from thrift stores, thinking about back to those online catalogs of men that I, online catalogs that I found for men that wanted to date a Dominican woman through on their vacation. So thinking about the consumer and the body that is consumed, but also going back to some ideas of the postcard series, making new bodies from the bodies that I found and kind of liberating these poses from their static form and making this installation where they're constantly recombining and making new compositions. Yeah, okay. I'll go through this. And then, so if you remember that postcard that I pointed at where I was talking about the relationship of how women and landscapes in tropical spaces are paired together, those collages directly inspire this body of work, which is called Containers, in which I am sewing bodysuits out of these fabrics where to encase myself in based on the poses from the Google search. So I started classifying the different poses from the Google search and putting them together, and the poses that repeated the most were used as inspiration for some of these bodysuits. And the idea of the series comes literally from wanting to make a three-dimensional manifestation of this two-dimensional collage. So I started sewing the bodysuits in this shape as wanting to translate the two-dimensional collage into real space. And then the spaces where I was photographing these containers. So like if you see here, the hands are sewn and the head are sewn in a way where like to put this thing on, you have to embody this pose. I didn't mean to do that. And then the containers are photographed in spaces that I'm interested in because they are natural looking, but not really. So this one is at Wave Hill, which is a garden in the Bronx. If you see here, there's a little tree label that tells you the species of that tree. So I'm interested in landscapes that look like they could be natural or have some idea of the natural embedded in it, but are really man-made or man-constructed or man-intervened. So this one is a concrete floor that has water, and then these plants are on planters, but you can't really see that. This is a beach that has extra sand brought into the beach because of erosion. So as a counter acting for erosion, they like refill the sand. Also, this happens sometimes when they want like lighter sand on a beach because it's prettier or whatever. This is also at Wave Hill, container number 4. Container number 5 was taken at the botanical garden in Santo Domingo. So you can see here some of the concrete floor coming through the leaves. Number 6, similar to number 3, is a beach that has been through like sand refill. And this one also relates to the postcard series. If you see like this siren shape is something that I was exploring in the postcards earlier. And this one was taken at the New York Botanical Garden in one of the greenhouses. And this is the first time that I'm playing with this idea of, this is really recent, this from 2020, playing with this idea of a photo inside a photo based on this photo printed on vinyl that I found on the greenhouse of a jungle. And it was covering some of the doors that lead to staff only area. So they have them covered with that. And when I went there to try to find a location to take the photo for this bodysuit, this was a great location. And if you see here, like the legs are sewn in a way that forces the performer to inhabit that pose. It's kind of like a triangular shape as opposed to a cylinder shape like as normal pants. They don't have a gap. It's just like one triangle. And then the hand is connected to the knee. And then the bodysuit photo series became performative when I started using the bodysuits for performances. And I invited different women to perform in this. And the logic of the performance, this one took place at Socrates Sculpture Park, and the second iteration took place at Wave Hill in the Bronx, both of these places in New York. The logic of the performance was that there was this audio track that was on a loop that lasted like 5 to 10 minutes. And while the audio is playing, the performer is instructed to be inside the bodysuit inhabiting the pose. And when it's not playing, so there's like little gaps of silence of like 2, 5, 10 minutes of silence in between each loop. When it's not playing, the performer can take off parts of the bodysuit and sit, relax, talk to people, stretch. And then when it plays back again, they're instructed to go back into the pose. So thinking about ideas of performativity and agency within that performativity. So kind of making fun of this idea of I'm performing for you or I'm only here. Well, actually, one of the phrases of one of the audio tracks is I'm here to entertain you, but only during my shift, which is also the title of my most recent solo show that just ended a few weeks ago. Let me show you a video and I will do silence for a minute so you can hear this. This is the documentation, an excerpt of the documentation of the performance.
Lodge, or how to lose your native accent in 5 quick steps. Whenever you forget, there will be someone there to remind you, diligently pointing out your difference. You can pretend to think about all sorts of universal things, but a stare, a tone, a question about your providence, or a damn will bring you back to your brown female perceivably foreign body. Having the mental space to fantasize about gardens and hikes and the universe is a privilege.
So went back to France. He used some of the renderings of flowers he extracted from his expedition as the basis for textile designs.
Dynamic of strangeness within the frame of familiarity construct the exotic, and yet the exotic is always in danger of losing its alien quality as he becomes domesticated.
Age 26, edible parts, rhizome, language, Spanish, kingdom, plantae.
Not the motherland, I'm not the landscape, I'm framing this composition. I'm not a flower, I'm only here to work. I'm here to entertain you, but only during my shift.
Okay, so going back to this, I'm gonna start going a little faster because I think time is running out and I haven't gotten to the installation of the Kemper. So this is a series that relates to the ideas of containers, but applied to public space and monuments. This is a monument of Christopher Columbus in the Bahamas that I wanted to cover, but I didn't. So I wasn't allowed to. This is a Photoshop montage. In 2017, I was invited to the Bahamas for an exhibition, a two-person exhibition with Didi Brown that was going to open on October 12th. So I was really excited about this date and talking about Columbus on this date. In the Bahamas, which is San Salvador, which is the first, is the island that is the first piece of land that Columbus saw supposedly when he arrived to this continent, belongs to the Bahamas. So I was very interested in having this conversation here. And so I proposed this. We talked with like the monuments people. It wasn't allowed to happen. We're still in conversation about it. It might happen in 2021. But it didn't happen in this occasion. And what I did was printing this Photoshop montage onto postcards and inviting the people, the Bahamian people that came to the exhibition to share their opinion on my proposal. So it's interesting because you have this archive of people's opinions in this postcard form. My favorite one is dominance concealed by tropical beauty. Perhaps the statue is a reminder of the political reality we are subject to. My ideas with bringing this tropical pattern to this statue of Columbus is a comment on how tourism in the Caribbean and in other tropical locations in many ways reproduces dynamics that are a continuation from colonial times. Literally, there's resorts that are situated in lands that used to be plantations, but also that manifest in other more subtle ways like divisions of labor and who it caters to and the things that it reproduces to cater to the audience it caters. Also, monuments like this are a touristic attraction. This will be a place like, it will be in tourist guides for you to go see this monument if you go here. And also thinking about the Bahamas and the Caribbean in general as this place where, sorry, something's falling. As this, I lost my train of thought. The Bahamas is very important for the cruise industry pre-COVID. It literally has an island that is for tourists only. Not that as a Bahamian you can't go in there, but they will make it hard and question your presence there. So certain dynamics around tourism that reproduce this colonial legacy. I did get to cover some Columbus statue in Miami last December, 2019. And then when I had the occasion of actually covering one, I decided to, instead of appropriating a design that already existed as I had been doing with my work in general, designing my own pattern. So the pattern for this, installation and also this one. So I got to cover two statues. That was Christopher Columbus and this one was Ponce de Leon. And I'll tell you more about their specific patterns in a minute. So this is a pattern that covers Ponce and the plant that I drew that is featured there, actually is in my studio right now, is an illustration of Manchinel or Manchineel, also known as Little Apple of Death. It's one of the most toxic plants on earth. And it was used by the Calusa natives of South Florida to poison their arrows at the time of the conquest. So the I was interested in highlighting instead of plants that were kind of superficially used throughout all of the tropics, regardless of geography, like, hibiscus or philodendron, using plants that were specific to the locations that I was doing the interventions in, but more importantly, that spoke to this history of resistance and resistance from the Native Americans and from the Afro-descending people that were brought to these places. So the Manchineel plant was used to poison the arrows of the used by the Calusa natives, including the arrow that struck Ponce de Leon that killed him. So that is the pattern that covers Ponce here. And then the pattern that covers Columbus features most prominently the castor plant, also the Rompe Saragüey plant, I don't know how to say that in English, and the Yaupon holly. And these were all plants that were important to people of African descent and indigenous people for in relation to traditions of despojo, which translates to English as dispossession, but it's really more like cleansing, purging, getting rid of energies and spiritual things. And also castor plant has another very potent toxin called ricin, which was recently sent to the White House in a letter. I thought that was funny. So ricin is a very toxic toxin. And the knowledge of separating the toxin from the healing parts of the castor plant and the castor plant itself were brought from Africa through the transatlantic slave trade. So that's the design that covers Christopher Columbus here. And I might need to skip through this, but this is a video that I shot in a cruise that you can see it on my website. It's called Labadee, and I was in a Royal Caribbean cruise and recorded the portion of the trip that where the cruise arrives to Labadee in Haiti. And I might as well just show you an excerpt since I'm talking about it. And the video kind of highlights the dynamics of this beach, which is close to, is fenced off all around. You can only enter it through the cruise or through some private boat. And then that creates this strange dynamics where people from the outside can come in, and the people who work inside, the people who are inside from, who are Haitian, are people who work for Royal Caribbean. The people who are performing here and the people who are selling you souvenirs are, people that pay Royal Caribbean a fee to be able to sell their services there. And then there's like this people from outside the fence asking for food from the all inclusive buffet inside the fenced off area. So the video meditates on all of these things and thinking about, you know, this different history. The video begins and ends with references to, historical references. So here, the last bit of subtitles as you are looking at the tourist here is, I wonder how many bodies have floated on it, on the water through the centuries. Let me see. And then it says, but the sea doesn't keep count. And then the video starts with excerpts from the diary of Christopher Columbus. When they first see land. And then in the middle, it's showing you more meditating on the aspects of the dynamics of this space in the present. Also related to this video and containers, the series is this series of spandex installations where I'm using the material that I was using to encase the body in the container series to create these architectural spaces that mediated the experience of space. And this one served also as a projection room for the video lab at the that you just saw an excerpt of. And thinking about like this pre-existing gates and holes that are the only places where you can go into the space of the exhibition further, and these barriers and obstacles as they relate to, again, the ideas of tourism and coloniality. For this one, we covered a booth on an art fair, and the only way that you could see what is the artwork inside was going through the spandex wall. And this one is more of a labyrinth. Okay, so Divergences is my most recent installation. And as you see, the works here relate to that series containers that I showed you earlier. So for Divergences, I visited Kansas City for the first time and was kind of doing research there. Also Jade helped me do that research. We went to the Black Archives of the Midwest, and there I learned about the history of townsite called Quindaro, a historic townsite outside of Kansas City that I became interested in. And if you are in Kansas City right now, you probably know more about this site than I do, but I learned about the history of Quindaro as it related to the Underground Railroad. It was a stop in that system, and it was a town that served as refuge for enslaved people that escaped and were traveling north to their freedom. So thinking about, and also subsequently, it was a place where Black families began to establish. And but the town side, the historic side had a short life, and it was kind of resurfaced a few decades ago when they were going to use the site as a landfill, and they had to do archaeological excavations as a prerequisite, and found the remains of the site. And we visited the place, but it was in the winter and we didn't really get to see a lot of the ruins, but I stayed interested in this history because it reminded me also of ideas of marronage as it manifested in the Caribbean. We have a lot of these histories of enslaved people that escaped to nature, to the mountains, to escape slavery. And as I was looking at these images and thinking about representation of landscape and going back to some of the ideas that I had been thinking about in previous works like Tropticon and the Ridicule series, how this idea of representation as it is tied to visibility and control, I ran into this image of Quindaro, which reminded me of this wallpaper by J.C. Eisenhart. And this kind of made me think about ideas of escape and escapism, and how escape can be this very different thing to different people. So like in this wallpaper was designed after the war and during a time where the post-war America wallpaper production had a lot of examples like this, where they're representing the bucolic pastoral countryside as a carefree playground, as a place to imagine ideas of escape and freedom and respite and rest. And then thinking of the history of Quindaro and how the ideas of escape in this place are so different. So this made me go back to my interest in landscape representation and in interior design and pattern design. And I took the Eisenhart wallpaper and separated the different colors, the 11 different colors that it had. Thinking about the process of making these wallpapers that is linked to these processes of printmaking design, printmaking process where you have like all of these layers that are printed onto each other. And as they come together, they create the recognizable imagery. So what I did was painting all of these different layers separately. And then when I put them back together, I wasn't interested in constructing any sort of landscape, but more referencing a pattern that was more as camouflage and thinking about how to visually maroon the landscape or subvert these representations as I was thinking of this historic town site. And then the works that are installed on top of the wallpaper are related to the container series. And they are specifically interested in a moment going back to that 2017 performance where you have different women coming in and out of the bodysuit. I was thinking of this moment where the performer is taking off the bodysuit, and I wanted to freeze that moment and look at it as a composition, and also the idea of taking off something, taking off this bodysuit or taking off this projection, but also denying visibility or consumption of your image to an onlooker. And then the patterns that I used for these photographic collages, they're photos that I used as a source for making collage. The patterns that I use for these are part of the patterns that I've been collecting as I have been researching and looking into this history of tropical pattern design. So I've run into these from looking for tropical patterns, fabrics and patterns, but something like this, or something like this, even though it's classified as tropical, it's kind of more elusive and nuanced. And I was interested in that in relation to these ideas of marooning representation. And I think I'll end here. I think I kind of went a little over because we probably needed some time for questions. But yeah, thanks so much for tuning into this, and let me know if you have any questions. Sorry that I run too late.
No, thank you so much. This was so wonderful, and it was so insightful to be able to hear about your practice and then your long history of art making. So if anyone has any questions here on Zoom, please feel free to put them in the chat, and then I will be sure to share them with Joiri. And while people are typing, I'll ask you a fun question. Yes. What did you enjoy most about your time in Kansas City?
Oh, geez. I feel like driving. I live in New York, so I am rarely in a car, usually in the subway, pre-pandemic, post-pandemic, just biking mostly. We'll see what happens in the winter. But I feel like just Jade was driving me around. And I think when we were going to Quindaro, it was super cold, and I was really enjoying just like the landscape in the highway going there. The food, we went to that place. I can't remember the name of it, but it was probably fried chicken or something chicken. Oh, barbecue. Oh. We went to a barbecue place. You took me to a barbecue place that I really liked. That was nice.
That feels like years ago.
Yeah. Well, it's like almost a year ago. That's true. Yeah. What else? What did I enjoy? I enjoyed the research. I really enjoyed the visit to the Black Archives of the Midwest. I took a million photos of like all of their presentations. And I really enjoyed visiting Quindaro too. We didn't get to go into that little museum that they had because it was closed because it was freezing or there had been a storm. But just being in that landscape was really incredible. Yeah.
Wonderful, thank you. And there is a question. Do you see it?
I see it, yeah.
Okay.
Is the leftmost frame piece referencing the Moor pattern of 18th European fashion? And what are your thoughts on the lifespan of patterns? Weird question, I know. Moor pattern, I am going to use my Google engine here and be like, what is this? I don't know what Moor pattern is. Moire pattern, is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know this. It could be referencing it. Moire, oh, okay, it's like this kind of like, from what I'm seeing in Wikipedia, it seems to be like the like stripes coming together and doing this like weird thing. I guess you do have a bit of like a Moire effect in that piece there with the blue, bluish aqua turquoise background. It's one of the fabrics that I found through this, like looking for tropical print on fabric production. And I was interested in it for a while, but didn't really know how to use it because it didn't fit the interest that I have in that other type of fabrics that have specific plants and landscapes that follow this specific history. So in this occasion where I was thinking of ideas of marronage in relation to the landscape, I thought it was good for this and I used it for that. I don't know if it references Moire in a, you know, European fashion from the 18th century sense. I also don't know what you mean by my thoughts on the lifespan of patterns. You mean like how they come into fashion and then like come out of fashion real quickly? I'm not sure if that is what you're saying, but, I will comment on, some of my research on tropical pattern design and how, actually I happen to be in my studio. So I'll just show you what I mean. So here, there are some of these patterns. So like I'm looking at this, for example, here, that is trying to reproduce some like vintage idea of tropical design, but it's made in like Illustrator in like this like vector sort of way. And I think that speaks to this desire of perpetuating or referencing those older traditions. And also like, what does that say about how we're keep prolonging the life of these ideas of tropicality in relation to that production. And yeah, so I see like longevity, if you wish, of pattern, not necessarily that they die out quickly, although that was my interpretation of your question. I don't know if that was the direction you were going to, but I'm gonna go to the next question.
Yeah, so there are a few questions about suits and spandex. So one is, are you drawn to using spandex because of its malleability, stretchy quality, or because it feels restrictive?
Yeah, I started using spandex because of its malleability, because I was doing this like bodysuits and encasing myself and other people in them. And it was very claustrophobic for the fabric to not be stretchy. So to make it a little easier on the process, I started using spandex. But I stay interested in it, also because of how, I don't know, it has a certain quality, like it like sticks to your body and it does that silhouette of your body in a very particular way that I think speaks to ideas and ways that we have seen gender bodies. It's a material that is feminized, just like tropical landscape is feminized. I'm interested in, because I'm interested in subverting all of those things, it made sense for me to stay using spandex.
Wonderful. And then how did you get started making?
Yeah.
Oh, what'd you say?
No, I was reading the question that you were about to read.
How did you get started making suits? Can you talk more about the process you used to cover statues?
Yeah, I got started making suits because of those collages that I showed you earlier, where I was covering the bodies of the women that came out in the photos, in the photo results from that Google search. I started covering them with patterns, like 2D patterns, thinking about the idea of denying the visibility of this woman for its consumption, and ideas of opacity. And so I literally just wanted to translate that two-dimensional, you know, covering of the body to a three-dimensional exercise. And I started doing my first bodysuit with that in mind. I just wanted to make a three-dimensional photo that was like the collage, but three-dimensional. And then that derived into further interest in some of other things, of some of the other things that were going on in doing that. And I can talk more about the process of covering the statues, yes. Do you mean like my process of how I got there? So I was talking to a curator, Nomaduma Masilela, in a studio visit once, and we were talking about the container series and talking about what other things could be covered with this spandex that I already had a history in my work of covering these bodies of women. And we started talking about public space, and it made me think about the statue of Christopher Columbus that was in front of my art school in Santo Domingo when I went there. And then the idea of covering that statue with the fabrics that I had been using made sense because of what I was talking about and how like this statue's become a touristic site, and then they relate to this history of tourism that kind of overlaps this history of colonialism. And from there, it kind of became, it made sense, and I kept pursuing that idea. And then the material or the, you know, manual process of doing that, also here, because I'm working in that series, you have like this huge pattern thing, and this is like, what is it? Colón, pecho, uno. So that's like half of the chest of the statue of Colón, of Columbus, that we covered in Florida. And then this is like the measurements of the statue. So the process involves getting someone on site to climb the statue and get me measurements of the whole thing. So like as much as possible, like, you know, this is like going around the head and the shoulder and the hand and whatever, because this is like a static, you know, piece of metal. It's really tricky to measure it. And then translating that to some sort of pattern design as it applies to cloth making. And I get the help of a person that does fashion for this process specifically. And we were figuring out, you know, how to translate this thing, because she had also never covered a statue with fabric. So it was a whole process to figure that out. But we made a lot of those huge drawings on pattern paper, and then cutting out the fabric, making the bodysuit. And then on site, I had some adjustments to make because it was a little too big on some places. So yeah, I don't know if that was the question, but.
Perfect, no, that's wonderful. And then can you explain more about why you wanted to extenuate/embrace the pixelation of the cutout pieces in the installation?
Yeah, I think at the time I had recently read Hiro Steyerl's In Defense of the Poor image, and was really into the ways that she was talking about pixelation as it related to ideas of the degradation of the image and the poor image, how it, you know, moves fast. It's like this small compressed image that is low quality. And I was also seeing those things in the photos that I was finding. And then the ways that those images live on the screen and how that translates to the printed image, has those pixels. And when I enlarged it, the pixels became even more notorious, and it started to abstract some of the features. So like when you see the whole thing, you obviously see a face and an arm and whatever, but when you see it up close, and I might have some of this. Here. Ooh. So I have one of the pieces here, actually. This one has a watermark. Some of them have watermarks. And then this one has the fabric in the back, like they all do. I don't know. I think it made sense with the imagery that I was using, but also it related to these ideas that I was interested in with the pixels, also in the larger wallpaper installations where pixelation is used to blur imagery that is meant to be very detailed. It's something that I go back in my work. And I guess in the Kemper installation, there isn't pixelation, but you do have this this like blurriness of the landscape or the representation in the way that the superimposition of the layers doesn't match. And it creates this kind of abstractness that when you get up close, you can see some, you know, little leaves or like a road or like little features that you would identify from a landscape, but you can't put it together in a certain way. So I think that's interesting. Also something that happens with the pixels to me.
Wonderful, thank you. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, yeah.
Okay, great, wonderful, thank you. And I'll give people in the chat, if you'd like to write in some more questions, please feel free to do that. In the meantime, I'll ask a question. Can you tell us a little bit more about your decision to use your own image in these works?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's something that I've been doing in a lot of my work, including the container series, the photo series, not the performance. For the performances, I use other people because I'm forced to use other people because I have to have like 4 or 5 people in the space. But I think thinking from Siboney and from the Dominican Women Google search and from the container series are all instances in which I'm examining my own identity in this place and in this context. I'm interested in the idea of embodying the stereotype and deconstructing it from within. And I think it's a conceptual idea and process, but it's also like a personal one of facing these things that I am being projected that are being projected onto me. For this is similarly, it's part of that same process of, decolonizing my body or something. I don't know if that makes sense to people listening. It makes sense to me.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. Thank you. And then we have another question. How has COVID affected your artistic perspective? Thinking specifically, since your work speaks about tourism/histories of travel, etc., with no tourism, How has your perspective shifted?
Well, that is questionable, that no tourism thing, because the Dominican Republic is one of the only countries that is receiving U.S. tourists. Unlike the almost rest of the continent that doesn't want to get more COVID, we are like, yay, come to us and spend money. So yeah, I don't know if tourism is stopping because of COVID, at least not in my, you know, context and experience and adjacency. My family is there and I don't know. For sure, it's going to change things, and it's been changing things, and it's been slowing things down. And I totally welcome the idea of exploring other models of revenue for countries that depend on this, because it's also the countries that depend on tourism in the way that the Dominican Republic does are also happen to be the countries that were formerly colonized and have this overlapping history. So it's a continuation of a hierarchy that comes from colonial times that I think could be very fruitful to rethink. And if COVID is giving us an opportunity to do that, I embrace that. But I don't think that is what is happening based on my experience with the with what's going on in the DR. Yeah, actually, a lot of hotels, I've been seeing a lot of people on Instagram in hotels, in all-inclusive resorts in the Dominican Republic. So yeah, I don't have like enough information. I don't have data and, you know, statistics to know the reality of the impact, but at least on image and visually and on the internet, it doesn't seem to have slowed down as we might want to think. Thanks for your comment, Mary.
Yes, thank you. Well, I want to make sure I haven't left any questions out on the question and answer on the chat. And
Yeah. Well, I'll read it for the recording.
I wonder if everyone can see these. Yeah, go ahead and read it.
Yeah, so Mary says she's personally loving Jade's personal textile coordination with the work, which I also loved. I didn't say it earlier, but I saw that. I was like, yes. And she also says, decolonizing your body, that is a very powerful act and desire. Thank you for articulating, and thank you for your comment, Mary. And then she says, all inclusive, that's another strong notion. Yes, that's another thing to unpack, the all inclusive experience.
Wonderful. Joiri, well, thank you so much. This has been so wonderful to hear about your work and to see you again virtually. And we so appreciate having this opportunity to speak with you. And everyone who's on Zoom, please be sure to come to the Kemper when you can to see Joiri Minaya Divergences. It'll be up until next summer. So thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. And thank you so much, Joiri. Everyone, have a wonderful night.
Thank you. Thank you, Jay. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in.
Yes, thank you.